So we've been celebrating African American History Month all month here on Space Station Live. And to continue that celebration, I'm joined today by Dr. Camille Alain, Associate Program Scientist for the International Space Station. Doctor, first off, thanks so much for joining me. Always great to get a chance to talk with you.
Always a pleasure, Dan.
And if I could just start it off, so let's jump right into it. What does, you know, African American History Month mean to you in the context of, you know, human space exploration?
What it means to me, it's an opportunity to celebrate and highlight the contributions of African American space explorers, space scientists, space engineers, people like who have paved the way, like Annie Easley, who was a computer scientist and mathematician and one of the first women in the pool of employees at the early days of NASA, at the what was then known as the Lewis Research Center, what we know as Glenn Research Center. And she was a woman who designed Centaur rockets.
Oh, wow.
Another woman is Katherine Johnson, who was only the third African-American to obtain a PhD in mathematics. And she designed mission profiles for very early human spaceflight missions, Mercury, Gemini, Apollo. And then more widely known is Dr. Mae Jemison, who's the first African-American woman to fly in space. So these African-American women were trailblazers. And because of their pioneering spirit, I am able to do what I do. And as a result, I stand on the shoulders of giants.
Okay, well, let's get into a little bit of how you do what you... So what was the path you took to end up, you know, sitting here in Mission Control at NASA with me today? Tell me about the road that led you here.
Okay, first of all, I was born on this small dot of a Caribbean island called Trinidad and Tobago. Mm-hmm. And I remember very early on at the age of 6 and 7, I would be fascinated by space. So I would sit on the trunk of my dad's car almost every night just being awe-inspired by space, not really knowing what that was, you know. In high school, I was really good in math and science. I excelled. I went to an all-girls school. And that was back in the days when girls were not pursuing science. They were not interested in science. So I was unique in that way. I had a love for planes, so I knew I wanted to design airplanes. But it wasn't until I was a freshman in college, I had just migrated to the U.S., and it was on that fateful day, January 28th, 1986.
You remember when the exact day?
I do remember. It was the Challenger, Space Shuttle Challenger accident. And that was a pivotal moment in my life, life-changing. And before that, I didn't know what NASA was, what a space shuttle was, that you could even have a job of flying in space. And so that really set the rest of the trajectory of my life. And I set my goal on working for NASA, designing spacecrafts and rockets, and maybe one day flying in space. And so 6 years after that day, after obtaining my bachelor's degree in mechanical and aerospace engineering, and my first master's degree in mechanical engineering, I was driving into the gates of Kennedy Space Center to an amazing 20-year career.
All right. Well, so we know how you got in, and now you're here today. So tell me about your job today. So what are you doing now?
So as the Associate Program Scientist for Communication, I'm the lead for all ISS research and how we communicate that. My responsibility, along with the extended team, includes increasing the awareness of the presence of the space station. And we've come a long way. There are a lot more people, for example, who knows about Scott's one-year mission than they did years ago when Shuttle retired and that we had six human beings living and working in space. So we've come a long way from then. But it's also important for us to not just increase the awareness of the presence, but what we are actually doing on the space station, the type of research and science we're doing, and more importantly, how that research has a benefit to improving the quality of our lives here on Earth. I also have the responsibility, along with the team, of increasing the use of the space station mm-hmm. by engaging the scientific community and increasing the awareness about ISS as a unique platform for scientific discovery and breakthroughs. And so we do all that by telling stories about science yep. in a way that the public could relate to. We use the multitude of social media platforms, mass digital and print media, to inspire the world. And for me personally, it's really about sharing my passion mm-hmm. for space exploration with the world.
Well, since you're a scientist, I can't get away without asking, you know, what's coming up? What's going to be the new stuff coming up in station science in the horizon?
So, of course, we're anticipating Scott and Mikhail's return on mm-hmm. March 1st after their one-year mission. But beyond that, we're preparing for the next cargo resupply mission to the yep. space station, OA-6, which is scheduled for the mid-March time frame. And there's some really new and exciting investigations going up on that mission.
Give me just one or two.
Starting with Meteor, the reflight of Meteor,
yes.
and we hope third time is a charm. But this is an investigation that allows scientists to make the first ever space obligations of observations mm-hmm. of meteors.
Oh,
you
wow.
know, meteors are pretty rare. And so scientists have only had the opportunity to observe them from the Earth mm-hmm. With the distortion and the interference of yeah. the Earth's atmosphere. And so now they have an opportunity for the first time to observe them from space and really study what their chemical composition
oh, cool.
is. And that allows them insight into the parent source of these meteors, whether it's asteroids or comet.
Mm-hmm.
Another one is the one that's garnering the interest of many people around the agency. It's the first in a series of investigations called SAFIRE, mm-hmm. Spacecraft Fire Experiments.
Oh.
And we will be studying large-scale fires on a space vehicle. You know, fires could be very, very mm-hmm. extremely detrimental in a spacecraft.
Yep.
And to date, we've only studied very small-scale flame growth
mm-hmm.
In a controlled environment. So SAFIRE intentionally lights a large scale fire
where
on the MT resupply Cygnus vehicle after it onboards from
okay.
the space station just before it re-enters the Earth atmosphere. And they're going to look at the rate of propagation of the flame in
oh,
space
wow.
and the consumption of the oxygen of that's feeding that flame. Ultimately, it's a realistic mm-hmm. way for them to study fires in future exploration vehicles.
That's really exciting.
Yeah.
All right. So just to close, we talked about the past and how we got to where we are. We talked about where we are now. Where do you see kind of human exploration going in the future?
So it is my hope that we continue to inspire the next generation of space explorers and
yep.
actually the space professionals. It's important for us to engage students in their studies of science, technology, engineering, and math in a way that they sustain their interests over a long period of time. It's also important for us to continue to increase the diversity, both from an ethnic and a gender perspective,
mm-hmm.
inspiring young people of color, young women to pursue careers in STEM. So it's important to have segments like this, continue to have segments like this so that young people can see themselves reflected, can see themselves represented, and know that they too can do
yeah.
have a career like this.
Absolutely. Yeah, so you too could be the next Dr. Camille Alane, Associate Program Scientist for the International Space Station. Doctor, again, thanks so much for joining me today.
Thank
it's
you, Dan,
always
for
informative,
having me.
Always great to have you.
Thank you.